Hello everyone, this is Dr. Ashish Onmai and welcome to chapter number 8, that is image segmentation. This is the part 1 of this video series. This is the brief outline of the chapter. We will first see detection of different types of discontinuities. Then we will see some algorithms for edge linking and boundary detection, which will be followed by thresholding and region-based segmentation. Let's start with the first part, that is different types of discontinuities and how to detect them. In the images, normally we have three types of basic discontinuities. The first one is point, the second is lines, and third is edges. Normally, whenever we want to detect these discontinuities, we use the process of mask processing or spatial domain filtering, where we use the spatial mask, normally of the odd size, and we find the resultant value as a weighted sum of the mask weights and the corresponding underneath subimage, and then we compare that result with a particular threshold, and based on that we take a decision. So here you can see there is a 3x3 mask shown, where the weights for different pixels are W1, W2, W3, so on up to W9. The underneath pixels we consider as Z1, Z2, Z3 up to Z9. And the result will be the weighted sum, which will be W1, Z1 plus W2, Z2, so on up to W9, Z9. And this result will then be tested against a threshold to make a decision. Let us first consider the point detection. In the point detection, the 3x3 mask used for identification of point discontinuity has a center element with the weight 8, and all the other 8 neighbors have weight of minus 1. Hence, if there is no discontinuity, then the result will be 0. If there is a point discontinuity, then the weighted sum will result in a very high value, since the isolated point or the center element will have a weight of 8. And when we consider whatever the result, the absolute value with the threshold, then if we have the value greater than threshold, we call it as a isolated point, else it is a normal image point. And the threshold normally used is a non-negative threshold, because we consider the absolute value of the resultant of the weighted sum. Consider an example shown over here. Now, in this particular image, there is a isolated point discontinuity. In fact, that is marked with a red arrow over here. Now, when we apply this mask on this image, and when we find the corresponding result using the spatial domain filtering, the result will be shown as that in second image. So this mask actually has detected various types of discontinuity which are present in the image. So it has also detected the edges, there are some lines, but if you observe, the brightest point in the second image is the point discontinuity which it has identified. If we choose the appropriate threshold, then this thresholding will eliminate all the unnecessary points, and what we will be left with is the only isolated point which we are interested in. The final output after thresholding is shown in figure 3 over here. Now let's move to the second type of discontinuity, which is line. So whenever we consider line, we are talking about a 1 pixel thick line over here. So the line can be either black, white, or any gray shade. On both sides of the line, we will have the constant gray area. Now the lines can be horizontal, vertical, or diagonal. So we have different types of masks to detect different types of lines. Normally the masks used are of size 3x3. So if you want to detect a horizontal line, the 3 cross 3 mask will have the first row as minus 1, the second row of 2, and third row will be again minus 1. For the vertical mask, the first column and the last column will be minus 1, whereas the center column will be having value 2. If you want to detect the diagonal edge along the plus 45 degree, then as you can see in the third image, we will have the value 2 along the 45 degree diagonal, and the remaining element of the mask will be minus 1. For minus 45 degree, the corresponding values of the mask along the minus 45 degree line or diagonal will be 2, and the remaining elements will be minus 1. Consider the example where we want to identify the line at minus 45 degrees. Now in this case, the first figure shows the original image. The second figure shows the result obtained after applying spatial domain filtering using the mask of minus 45 degrees. And the third figure shows the result after thresholding. Now, if you observe this image carefully, you may find that there are lines of various thicknesses in it. Some of the lines are horizontal, vertical, some of them are 45 degrees, some of them are minus 45 degree, or some other angles also. Now, what we are interested is to identify a 1 pixel thick line at minus 45 degrees. Now, in fact, if you observe carefully, there are two lines at a minus 45 degrees over here. Out of these two lines, this line is actually having a thickness more than 1 pixel, whereas this line is 1 pixel thick at minus 45 degrees. So this is the line in which we are interested in. We take the mask of minus 45 degree line detection and we will perform the spatial domain filtering operation on the input image. The corresponding result is shown in the second figure. So here you can see that along with that line that we are interested in, the mask has also detected some other lines or the discontinuities in the image. This is basically because that the mask that we are considering is a high pass filtering mask, and by default it is going to identify the discontinuities in the image. After spatial domain filtering, we will choose an appropriate threshold and we will perform the thresholding operation. The thresholding operation will eliminate the unnecessary discontinuities are detected, and the only thing that will be left will be the lines at minus 45 degrees. So this is the final result of our line detection. Now let's move to the third discontinuity, that is edge, and how to detect it. So whenever we consider an edge in an image, it will be a step like a function. So there will be one gray level on the one side of the edge and there will be other gray level on the other side of the edge. So you can see the model of an ideal edge in the first image. So the image profile is shown on the top and the corresponding gray level profile is shown at the bottom of that particular figure. However, practically in the actual scenario, we don't get a step function, but what we get is a ramp function in the actual images. So the model of a raw ramp edge is shown in the second figure, where the image is shown at the top and the corresponding gray level profile is shown at the bottom of that particular figure. So now if you consider a region that is separated by a vertical edge and that vertical edge happens to be a ramp edge, then the corresponding gray level profile is what is shown over here in the second image top part. Now, we have already seen that we can use either a gradient or a Laplacian operator to identify the edges in the spatial domain filtering. Now, if you use a gradient to identify or to detect this edge, then it will result into a pulse like structure which is shown in the second part of the second figure. Whereas if you use the Laplacian will result in the two impulses which is shown in the third part of the second figure. So the gradient will be the first order derivative and the Laplacian will be the second order derivative of that particular rampage. So depending on what suits our application, we can use either the first order derivative, that is the gradient, or second order derivative, that is the Laplacian. Okay, of course, you can see that in the Laplacian there will be two impulses of the different polarities. We can use a zero threshold to remove the negative impulses and preserve the positive impulses. However, main problem starts when the images are noisy. So let's first see what the effect it will have when there is a noise present in the image and how the gradient and the Laplacian will behave. So let's consider that we have a rampage. So if there is no noise in it, then we can see the result of the gradient and the Laplacian, where the gradient will have a pulse kind of structure and the Laplacian will result in two impulses. Now let's consider that we add a Gaussian noise to it. So currently the noise what we add has a zero mean, and let's consider that the variance of the noise is 0.1. So there is a very small amount of noise that is added. So if you see the gray level profile of that noisy edge, then we don't see much variation in it. However, when we apply the edge detection using gradient, you can see that noise gets amplified. And the noise will get more amplified when we use the Laplacian. Now if we increase the variance, let's say the variance is now 1. So now that variance, that noise will start appearing in the gray level profile also. And as we apply the gradient and Laplacian, the noise will get more and more amplified. The gradient will amplify the noise and the Laplacian will further amplify the noise. So if you see the gray level profile of the edge detection of the gradient and Laplacian, you will find that the results are very noisy now. And as the noise increases further, so you can see that when the variance is 10, we cannot identify where is the edge when we apply the gradient and Laplacian. Hence, whenever we do a edge detection application, we always want that the images should be noise free. So for practical scenarios, we will first perform the elimination of noise and then we will apply the edge detection. Let us first discuss the gradient operator. As we have already seen in the spatial domain filtering, the gradient is a vector consisting of two elements, x gradient and y gradient. And the magnitude of the gradient is given as square root of gx square plus gy square. We normally approximate the magnitude of the gradient as mod of gx plus mod of gy, where gx is the gradient along x direction and gy is the gradient along y direction. We can have a different mask, as we have already seen in the spatial domain filtering. We can have a mask for simple gradient which detects the horizontal or vertical edges, or we can have a robot's mask which detects the discontinuities or the edges along the diagonal, or we can have a Privet operator, or we can have a Sobel operator. In all these cases, we can see that there are two masks. The first mask corresponds to the x gradient, that is gx, and the second mask corresponds to the y gradient, that is gy. Let's consider an example over here. We are using a Sobel mask to identify the edge over here. There are four figures. The first figure shows the original image. The second figure shows the result of x gradient. The third figure shows the result of y gradient. And the fourth figure shows the final gradient result obtained using mod of gx plus mod of gy. Now here, if you see the result of gx, then you will find that it predominantly captures the horizontal edges The result of GY predominantly captures the vertical edges. So when we combine both of them, that the final gradient will have both horizontal as well as the vertical edges. However, if you observe carefully, the final result also has highlighted the noise. This is because the building structure, what we seen, there is a roof portion or the walls, their gray levels are not constant. There are small fluctuations or the variations in the gray levels of the roof or the walls, and this is somewhat kind of a noise in that gray levels. Hence, when you find the gradient, it has actually given the edges, but along with that, it has also highlighted those variations. So to eliminate this noise, what we can do is we can first smooth the image with some smoothing filter, and then we will apply the gradient operator on it. So here, let's consider that we smooth the image with a 5x5 smoothing filter or the simple averaging filter. So that a smooth image is shown in the first figure over here. The corresponding X gradient is shown in the second figure. The corresponding Y gradient is shown in the third figure, and the final gradient is shown in the fourth figure over here. Now, if you see the gradients or the final gradients, then you will obviously find that since we have smoothed the image before applying the gradient, the noise is eliminated. And what we see is only the horizontal or the vertical and combinedly the diagonal edges in the results. We can also have the mask which can detect the diagonal edges for Prewitt or Sobel. So these masks are shown over here. So this is an example of using the diagonal mask of Sobel operator. So you can see that the X gradient and Y gradient, instead of capturing the horizontal and vertical edges, they now capture the diagonal edges. Here the X gradient predominantly captures the edges at minus 45 degrees, whereas the Y gradient predominantly captures the edges at plus 45 degrees. Now let's move to the second order derivative or the Laplacian operator. So as we are aware that the Laplacian of an image will be del square f upon dx square plus del square f upon dy square, or we can say it is a second order derivative along the x direction and y direction. We have also seen that this mask can be in the form of 4 neighbors or 8 neighbors. And also the weight can be positive and negative depending on how you choose them. So in this slide, you can see the Laplacian mask with the centers positive. So for 4 neighbor, the center value will be 4, and the 4 neighbors will have a value of minus 1, whereas the diagonal neighbors will have a value of 0. For the 8 neighbor case, we will have the center with the weight 8, and all the 8 neighbors will have a value of minus 1. Of course, we can change the signs. Okay, so we can have the center with the negative. In that case, the corresponding 4 neighbors or 8 neighbors will have a plus 1 value. However, we have already seen that the Laplacian filter is very sensitive to the noise. So whenever there is a noise, that noise will get amplified whenever you apply the Laplacian filter. And also the Laplacian produces the double edges. So normally we don't apply the Laplacian directly on the image. Instead of that, what we do is we first smooth the image with a Gaussian filter, and after that we apply the Laplacian filter. And this gives us to a filter called as log filter, which is nothing but a Laplacian of a Gaussian. So the idea over here is to smooth the filter first with the Gaussian filter, then apply the Laplacian on it. But when we apply the Laplacian, there are two edges that we get. So what we do is we use the zero crossing property of the Laplacian, and this enhances the performance very high. So consider we have a 2D Gaussian filter, which we are representing as HR, which will be given as minus of e raised to minus r square upon 2 sigma square. where r square will be x square plus y square, and sigma will be the standard deviation. So if we convolve this function, this it will blur our image, and the degree of blurring will depend on the value of sigma. So what we do is we take the Laplacian of this HR. So we are taking the second order derivative of H with respect to R, and that corresponding value will be del square HR will be minus of R square minus sigma square upon sigma raised to 4 multiplied by e raised to minus R square upon 2 sigma square. And this function is called as Laplacian of Gaussian function. So if we vary the values of x and y, and if we plot this function in 3D, then what we get is a somewhat like a Mexican hat like a structure. So that 3D plot is shown in figure 1 over here. The corresponding image representation of this del square h with respect to x and y is shown in figure 2. The corresponding gray level profile is shown in figure 3 over here. Now, since it has a shape of a Mexican hat, sometimes this log function or Laplacian of Gaussian function is also called as a Mexican hat function. Now, if we convert this gray level profile to a spatial mass, then we can obtain a 5 cross 5 spatial domain mass for a Laplacian of Gaussian. And this mask will have the center value as 16. The four neighbors at the first level will have a value minus 2. The diagonal neighbors at the first layer will have the value minus 1. The four neighbors of the second level will have the value minus 1, and the remaining values will be 0. Or we can consider a diamond like shape over here where the center is 16. The first diamond layer has the value minus 2, and the second diamond layer has the value minus 1 over here. Now let's consider an example over here. Now in this example, we have an image of vein structure over here. And in fact, these veins have some blockages, which we cannot see by naked eyes in our image. Also, if we apply some edge detection algorithm, like let's say we apply a Sobel operator, still we will not be able to identify those blockages. Okay, so first figure over here actually shows the original image or the veins image. The second image shows the output of the Sobel gradient. And you can see that the red ovals actually indicate the position of the blockages which are present, but both the original image and the Sobel operator could not highlight those blockages. So what we do is we process this image with the log operator, that is the Laplacian of Gaussian. So we are going to smooth the image first with the Gaussian filter, which is shown in the third figure over here. And then we are going to apply the Laplacian operator on it, which is shown in the fourth figure over here. Instead of doing the two operations separately, what we can do is we can use that 5 cross 5 mask which we have discussed in the earlier slide. And we can apply that 5 cross 5 mask directly on the image, which will give us the output of a log filter or the Laplacian of Gaussian. Okay, and the corresponding output is shown in the fifth figure, that is the first image of the second row. Now here we cannot clearly see it directly. So what we do is we threshold the output which we obtained after log filtering. And now if you see, you can clearly see that this thresholded output clearly highlights the blockages which are present in the vein. Then we can use the zero crossing property of the log filter, and we can then find out the edges of the structure over here, and that result is finally shown in the last image of second row. So this brings us to the end of part one of this video series of image segmentation. Thank you.